विद्विषावहैः। ओम शांति शांति शांति। समस्त जन कल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्म विद्वरं सच्चिदानंदरूपाय विश्वोत्पत्यादिहेतवे तापत्रयविनाशाय श्रीकृष्णाय वयं नमः। विल चैंट दिस श्लोक। नारायणं पद्मभुवं वसिष्ठं शक्तिं च तत्पुत्र पराशरं च व्यासं शुकं गौड़पदं महांतं गोविंद योगींद्रमथास्य शिष्यं श्री शंकराचार्यमथास्य पद्मपादं हस्तामलकं च शिष्यं तं तहुटकं वार्तिककारमन्याद् अस्मन् गुरुन् संततमानतोऽस्मि। सो द सेकंड हाफ ऑफ दिस वी हैव टू स्प्लिट लाइक श्री शंकराचार्य मथास्य पद्म पादं च हस्तामलकं च शिष्यं तं तोटकं वार्तिककारमन्यान् अस्मद् गुरुं संततमानतोऽस्मि। ओके, सो वी हैड सीन द डिस्क्रिप्शन गिवन बाय ब्रह्मा जी, आई मीन द भागवतम गिवन बाय ब्रह्मा जी, देन ब्रह्मा जी गेव इट टू भागवतम गिवन बाय नारायण भगवान टू ब्रह्मा जी, ब्रह्मा जी गेव इट टू नारद जी, हु गेव इट टू व्यास महर्षि, हु गेव इट टू सुखदेव जी, एंड सुखदेव जी गेव इट टू परीक्षित राजा, एंड सूत जी इज गिविंग दैट टू शौनक ऋषि एंड द रेस्ट ऑफ देम इन नैमिषारण्य। सो इन दिस कॉन्टेक्स्ट वन थिंग इंपॉर्टेंट टू नो इज दैट this is the parampara of the guru shishya. Bhagavatam is a purana. So what is the difference between an itihasa and a purana? Technically, if we do the classification of shruti, smriti, purana, etc., then itihasa purana is one, itihasa also is a part of purana, but we separate it as itihasa because itihasa is itiha asa, it thus happened. So it is historical, it is chronological, and it is ghatana pradhan. It is having the importance of the events that have happened. Of course, from that we learn many things. But purana is not chronological. Purana is not necessarily it has thus happened like this only. Sometimes it may be symbolism, sometimes it may be mysticism, sometimes it may be Vedantic meaning. Sometimes it will be that events have happened. Sometimes it will be that they have not happened here, they have happened in higher worlds, or they have happened in like here, the beginning of creation and all that. Itihasa speaks about here. So itihasa is ghatana pradhan and purana is shiksha pradhan. So we may try and see the connection between the various chapters, etc., but the knowledge is most important because it is shiksha pradhan. So now comes in this second chapter the discourse that happens now, that is the 10th discourse of the second chapter. So the question that Parikshit Raja had asked Shukdev ji, he said these questions Brahma ji had asked, and he narrated the whole thing what we saw in the previous chapter, and then Brahma ji gave it to Narad ji, which came to Vyas ji, which came to him, and now Shukdev ji is going to speak about that in response to Parikshit Maharaj's questions. So his questions are there, and the answer to that is now this chapter, which has 10 characteristic features of Bhagavatam. And in throughout Bhagavatam, you will find the elaboration of these 10. So apart from the Chatushloki Bhagavat, which is the knowledge essence of the entire Bhagavatam, these 10 aspects are the features which make this Bhagavat as a Mahapurana. So there is a difference between Purana and Mahapurana. So 18 Puranas are there. In 18 Puranas, Bhagavat is called as Mahapurana. Others are called Purana. So what is the difference? Puranas deal with 5 topics. Mahapurana will deal with 10. So now what are the topics of Purana? So Sarga means creation. See, Mahapurana will also cover some of these. I'm just going to mention right now, then we will come into the shloka part here. So Purana covers 5 aspects, which is Sarga, which is Bhagavan's creation. Then Pratisarga or Visarga, they both mean the same. So that is the creation by the others, using Bhagavan's creation. So like Bhagavan creates 5 elements, and using 5 elements, what Brahmaji and the other devatas and even human beings that we create, that is called Visarga or Pratisarga. So Sarga is one topic, Visarga or Pratisarga is another topic. You know, like example, rice is Sarga, idli is Visarga. It's like that. Now don't say that rice also is created by human being, Visarga also created by human being. It's just an analogy. To say that modification of using that rice, you make products, no? That idli and whatever, dosa and all that, then that is Visarga. Like that, the basic raw material, the basic creation is what the Lord made, and using that, what else comes out, that is Visarga or Pratisarga. So Sarga, 1, Visarga, Pratisarga, 2, then Manvantara is the Manu. And what is the dharma of that Manu, and how the Manu takes forth the creation as well as establishes dharma, that is Manvantara. Then Vamsha is the dynasties, broadly solar and lunar dynasty, Vamsha. And Vamshanucharitam is how the great people of these dynasties have lived. These 5 things are covered by any Purana. But a Mahapurana will cover 10. So this chapter now is the discourse number is also 10. And the characteristics of Mahapurana also are 10. So now Shukadevji starts. Shri Shuka Uvacha Atra Sargo Visargascha Sthanam Poshanam Utayaha Manvantaresha Nukatha Nidodho Mukti Rashrayaha. If you can memorize and you want to memorize, memorize this verse. Because this covers all the 10 topics. One verse. So what are these 10 here now? Sarga. Those 10 will get elaborated here also. In this next few shlokas, each one, what it is also described. So but just to enlist. Sarga, topic 1. Visarga, topic 2, Sthanam, 3, Poshanam, 4, Utayaha, 5, Manvantara, 6, Ishanukatha, 7, Nirodha, 8, Mukti, 9, Ashraya, 10. These are 10 topics. By elaborating on these 10 topics, now the answers of Parikshit Raja's questions are being given. So now what does he say here? Before he goes on to elaborate each one, what he says is dashamasya vishuddhyartham navanamiha lakshanam varnayanti mahatmanah shrutenarthena chanjasa. So he says here that the 10 topics, of the 10 topics, the most important one is the 10th one. All the 9 are for the 10th one actually. Dashamasya vishuddhyartham. Vinavanam iha lakshanam. These 9 are elaborated to present the 10th one very clearly. So all the great Mahatmas, Varnayanti Mahatmanaha, how? Shrutenarthena. By using the text itself and sometimes by context, by understanding the context and the implied meaning, they have come to understand that the description of 9 is meant for the 10th one. What is the 10th one? Ashraya. What in bhakti we call as ashraya, Bhagavan is ashraya, and we surrender to the Lord, we take refuge in the Lord. He is our refuge, he is our shelter, is ashraya. In Vedanta we call as adhishthana, the substratum. To know the substratum is to know the truth in Vedanta. Like the pure consciousness is the substratum of the whole universe. To know that is to realize. And here it is to know the ashraya, to lose one's identity in the ashraya through complete surrender, is to know, become one with Bhagavan. So what helps is the other 9 to help us surrender to that Supreme Lord. Because all the 9 are connected by the connected and they lead to Bhagavan only. So now what are these 9? What are all the 10 basically? So bhuta matrendriya dhyam janma sarga udahritaha. So this is the meaning of sarga. Coming from bhuta. So in this bhuta word, if you see the translation, is the gross and the subtle elements, both. So gross and the subtle elements, meaning 5 tanmatras, then their grossification, that is gross and subtle elements. Bhuta, matra. So matra means the senses. Matra, sparshas, to kaunteya, in the Gita it comes. So matra means senses here. Matra indriya. So the senses of perception and the action is matra. Then indriya here means mind, the antar indriya, because the 10 senses of knowledge and 10 senses, knowledge and action, they are already covered by matra. So indriya here means mind. So mind here means the antakarana, the mana buddhi, chitta ahankara, that. Then dhyam is the total intellect, mahatattva, and then this is given here as mahatattva, the principle of cosmic intelligence. And beyond that is avyakta actually. Then comes Brahman. So that is in Vedanta, we understand that. So here is this creation. Bhuta matre indriya dhyam janma. The creation of these is called as sarga. The birth of this is called as sarga. So right from unmanifest to mahatattva to the subtle body of the jivas to the 5 senses of knowledge, 5 senses of action, the 5 elements, means the objects in the world also are covered in that actually. That's why in the translation again reverse order, otherwise the elements will come before the senses and all that. So Sarga means what is created basically by the Lord. And now there are two meanings here of Visarga. Because see, in this commentary, in this shloka, what did he said? Brahmano guna vaishamyad visarga paurusha smritaha. In Brahman, when there is equilibrium of the three gunas, sattva, rajas, tamas, meaning in maya, I should not say Brahman. Brahman's power is maya, so by that Brahmana, it is referred to maya shakti. By the will of the Lord it happens, so Brahmana, it is said here. Otherwise, Vaishamya, Guna Vaishamya is in the Maya. So this Maya has three gunas in equilibrium, Samyavastha it is called. When that equilibrium is disturbed by a sankalpa of the Supreme, then the further srishti starts. And that is why the creation is predominantly because of Rajas and Tamas. If Vishuddha Sattva happens, one will realize absolute. So this imbalance of the three gunas, then the Srishti will start. So that is called as Visarga here. Visarga Paurusha Smritaha. No, actually it should be the, till Brahmano Guna Vaishamyad is Sarga. Sorry, my mistake. Till Brahmano Guna Vaishamyad is Sarga. The Srishti happens by the will of the Lord. When the three gunas get disturbed, then this Avyakta and Mahatattva and then the rest of the things what we learned, all that happens. So till Guna Vaishamyad is Sarga. Then what is Visarga? Visarga is Paurusha Smritaha. Using this, what the human being, the Jiva creates, or the Devatas, or even Brahmaji, they create, that is called Visarga. So creation of animate and inanimate beings by Brahma is called Visarga. So that is Visarga. So basic raw material is created by Bhagavan. Using that, whatever we create, or whatever even cosmic intelligence like the creator, Brahmaji creates, that is called Visarga. Now this is interesting to know. Now, even though science may believe in so many things, science cannot create five elements and science cannot create the laws governing the five elements. Science can only discover them. These are the laws and this is how it is functioning. But who created it? So even a scientific minded person will have to believe that there is an existence of a cosmic intelligence which is beyond this, beyond the perceptible knowledge that we have of the science. There is a cosmic intelligence which has created the basic raw material. And if somebody says, no, it just happened by Big Bang, it happened. And that is the process you are describing. Who created those aspects? By whose will does it happen? What is the intelligent cause? That science has no answer for. They can only describe a process, the raw material from where it came. If one says, it was a dot and then it expanded, Big Bang happened. How? Process, you are saying how it happened. But the five elements and these things got created by a certain intelligent cause. And this expansion, contraction of the creation. Continuous expansion happens till some phase and then again it contracts, it goes back to a dot, again it expands, again it contracts. This loss, who created? Science didn't create. There is an intelligent cause behind it. So the last one, Ashray, is to help. The main one is the Ashray. These 10 are to lead us to that. Who is the creator of Sarga? Bhagavan. Who is the Ashray? Visarga, the power to create using what Bhagavan created. Brahmaji creates using what Bhagavan created. That came from where? The earlier chapter itself we saw that Brahmaji was clueless and then he heard tapa. So he did tapasya, and then Narayan Bhagavan's darshan he had. And then he got the knowledge, and from there he started. And that Brahmaji is also Narayan Swarup only. In this chapter also it will come. So Visarga is by Bhagavan's grace, Visarga also is by Bhagavan's grace. We may do whatever creation in our, because Bhagavan has given us the buddhi. So using buddhi, we may create technical, advancements and technology and other things also we create. Art, literature, science, music, dance, so many things we create. But the basic capability in the buddhi to think came from where? How are the inner things functioning? All that is the intelligent cause. So all the 10 should, all the 9 should lead us to appreciate the Supreme. That's the objective of this Bhagavatam. So that is Sarga and then Visarga. Then Sthanam, what was said, is the third one. So here it is Sthitihi Vaikuntha Vijayaha. So this Sthiti is Vaikuntha Vijayaha. What is the meaning of that? The triumph of the Lord, as revealed by the fact that living beings created by Him keep within their bounds, is known by the name of Sthiti. And the Lord's grace on His devotees is termed as Poshana. So Sthiti, one meaning of the word Sthiti is sustenance. So Bhagavan did the creation, now one has to sustain. So that's why he said the translation is sustenance. Here it is said Sthitihi Vaikuntha Vijayaha. Sustenance is to ultimately lead us to that state of Vaikuntha only. Why are we living in this world? To realize Brahman, otherwise it's useless. And Bhagavan sustains us till the Vaikuntha Vijaya doesn't happen. Meaning till that person doesn't realize Brahman, who sustains? Life after life. So Sthiti is not only the Jiva, the sustenance of the Jiva in one life. Sthiti means sustenance of the Jiva life after life, till that Jiva doesn't attain Vaikuntha Vijaya, meaning till the Jiva doesn't become one with Bhagavan. Sustenance. And so that's why he says the triumph of the Lord. So Vaikuntha Vijaya. Sthitihi Vaikuntha Vijaya. Poshanam tad anugraha. And not only sustenance, the Lord has to nourish also. So Poshanam tad anugraha, by His grace. And how does He nourish? See, one is when He says yoga kshemam vahamyaham, He nourishes the jivas. That verse is very interesting. Ananyas chintayanto mam ye jana paryupasate tesham nityabhiyuktanam yoga kshemam vahamyaham. Bhagavan takes care of the yoga, what the devotee needs but doesn't have, and what the devotee has, how to protect that. So what he needs, he doesn't have, Bhagavan gives him, that is yoga. And what he has already, Bhagavan helps to protect that. Yoga kshemam vahamyaham. For whom? For this devotee who is continuously thinking about Bhagavan. Ananya chintayantomam ye jana paryupasate. Such devotees who are continuously striving to know the Lord, of those devotees, Bhagavan takes care of yoga and kshema. Now somebody says, oh, so I don't have to work. So if I don't work and only remember God, God will take care of my yoga and kshema. One disciple asked the Guru. Guru said, no, He will not take care. No, but you said, yoga kshema vahamyaham, Gita, Bhagavan said that. He said, that is for ananyas chintayanto mam. Mam there means Bhagavan. You are doing ananya chintan of your yoga and kshema. Why will Bhagavan take care of that then? You are anyway taking care of it. If you forget all those and you are lost in thinking about Bhagavan, then Bhagavan's grace, it will take care, Bhagavan will take care of your yoga and kshema. Oh, but then what does it mean? Bhagavan is partial to devotees. No, He is taking care of the so-called non-devotees also. How? By inducing purushartha kshamata in them. what we think that we are doing, my work, my achievement, my thing, that also is Bhagwan induced only. So Bhagwan only is indirectly taking care of yoga kshema by our purushartha. But then why in the devotee that is not there? Because the devotee has gone beyond this purushartha of artha, kama, dharma and even moksha. That devotee is seeking the pancham purushartha, that is bhakti. So if the devotee has gone beyond artha, kama, dharma, moksha, of such devotees, the devotee doesn't even have to bother where the food will come from, because the mind of devotee is not in that. Bhagwan will anyway take care of that person. Special things also Bhagwan may do to take care of that person. So now, those are the ananya bhaktas who don't have to worry about the sustenance of their body also. Bhagwan will take care. Those who are not ananya bhaktas, what will Bhagwan do? He will induce purushartha kshamata in them. And he also nourishes by his own form, his own name, his own leelas. He nourishes that bhakti also. The non-believers, he brings them to satsang. Or he gives some wake-up calls in life which will make them seek the deeper. All this is nourishment of Bhagwan only. Poshanam. Poshanam tad anugraha. The grace of Bhagwan is what is nourishing us. And that grace is always present. That's the beautiful aspect. Whether we know it or not, grace is always present. Like sunlight is there, now I have to open my door. To the extent I open my door or window, to that extent light will come inside. Example, there is a limitation that the sun cannot make you open the door or window. Here Bhagwan can make us open the door and window also. By taking us to satsang, by making us reflect, by making us think, by making us understand the limitation of the world. So that is poshanam. One should ask oneself, who is the one who has given birth to me and who is nurturing me? It is not only the mother and father in this physical world. They are the physical parents of this body. They are also nourished by someone else. Don't say it is only their parents. Even if you say that, ultimately one will trace back to Bhagwan only, because it will come to Sarga. So from Poshana to Visarga to Sarga only will come. And who is the creator of that? Who is taking care of that Sarga is Bhagwan only. But beyond that is to understand that the capabilities in the parents to take care also comes from Bhagwan only. Who is protecting the child in the womb? Parikshit is a big example of that or not? Bhagwan is protecting the child in the womb. And according to the karma of the jiva will get the results. So that is the next one. That is called utaya. It will come after manvantara. So poshanam tad anugraha. The grace of the Lord is poshana. That's why in the Gita it is said, pitaha masya jagataha mata dhata pitamaha. I am the father of the universe. I am the mother of the universe. Pitahamasya jagataha mata dhata. I am the nourisher. Pitamaha. And I am the great, I am the grandfather also. Meaning he is everything. Material cause also is Bhagwan. Intelligent cause also is Bhagwan. Causeless cause also is Bhagwan. He is the everything. And he only nourishes. Oshanam tad anugraha. Then manvantarani saddharmaha. So each manvantara, so a jiva becomes a manvantara. Jiva becomes a manu, and the span of that manu is called manvantara. So right now is the 28th manvantara going on. I think 71 manvantaras will be there is one calculation I could tell. Yeah. I think in the term of in the lifespan of one Brahmaji, I think 71 Manvantaras come. Some such calculation is there. I forgot. I will put on the group. So each Manu has a specific time period. Just like we have 5 years for the government, like that, every Manu has a certain time period. In that time period, how that Manu establishes Dharma. So like we have Smritis, no? Various Smritis. Manu Smriti is one Smriti, where Manu and Shatrupa, they are the two who take forward the creation. So that Manu is a position. So Manvantara. So we say Swayambhu Manu. Like that there are, now this is the 28th Manvantara going on. Means 28 people have become Manus in this cycle of Brahmaji's, this Brahmaji's life. So like that, what that Manu establishes, that is called Manvantara. So Manvantara, Manvantarani Saddharmaha. Utayaha Karma Vasanaha. So each Jiva gets the results according to their karma, which are prompted by their vasana. So the janma, etc., is based on that. So that is called Uti. Though Bhagwan is same to all, because the buddhi is given in the manushya yoni, then there is a difference because each one makes their choices. So then the karmas, etc., become different. So Utayaha means that karma vasana. Then now in this also, so we saw Sthiti is done by Bhagwan, Poshanam is also done by Bhagwan. Manvantarani Saddharma, this Manu who establishes Dharma, how does Manu establish Dharma? Manu also gets knowledge from Bhagwan only to establish Dharma. Then Karma Vasana. So Karma Adhyaksh is Bhagwan and Karma Faladata also is Bhagwan. The Karma Adhyaksh means one who presides over the capability in us to act. Because the presence of the Lord is there in us, his body, mind, intellect can act. Though we have this Purushartha Kshamata, we have that freedom or the free will, which we can use to make ourselves, mar ourselves, but Bhagwan is a Karma Adhyaksha. And Karma Phala Data also, we do our actions, but how we get results? Very fact that we get results proves that there is one intelligent entity who created the laws according to which we get the result. So neither the jiva is supreme, nor the laws are supreme, nor karma is supreme, nor karma phala is supreme. Then who is supreme? Ishvara only. Upadeshar also begins with that. Karturajnaya prapyate phalam. Karma kim param karma tadjadam. Karma is only jadavastu. By the will of the supreme creator only the karma phala also happens. Even karma happens, otherwise karma is jada, karma cannot happen. Karma needs a karta. Karta is who? I. From where did this small I come? Is a big I only enlivening this BMI. So this also leads to ashray, Bhagwan. So utayaha karma vasanaha. Then avataranu charitam harehe cha asya anuvartinam. See, so Ishanu katha, what was said, na, after Manvantara, Poshanam Utayaha, then Manvantara. In the earlier shloka, in the first shloka, there is a change. After Poshanam comes Utayaha. In the explanation, Manvantara has come before Utayaha. So just be clear on that. So after Manvantara comes Isha Anukatha. So Isha Anukatha is this, Avataranu Charitam Hareshasya Anuvartinam. Satam Isha Katha Proktaha Nana Khyanopa Brahmitaha. So the Lord who is the karma adhyaksha, karma phala data, who nourishes the jiva, who through the manu establishes dharma. When that dharma gets declined, that dharma, to revive it, what will Bhagavan do? Initially, he may send the saints. So, Hare Shcha Anuvartinam. Those who are the devotees of the Lord, those who are saints and sages, Bhagavan sends them and through their life establishes dharma, revives dharma. But if required, Bhagavan himself also comes. That is the uniqueness of the Vedant philosophy, Avataravad. So, Avatara Anucharitam. And so the Charitra of that avatar. So, in Bhagavatam, many avatars, the Charitra will come. We have seen about it earlier. There are many avatars. There are not only 10. Two times we have seen the different avatars that were mentioned in Bhagavatam. So, Bhagavan takes avatar out of compassion for the jiva. And all his devotees, the saints, sages, the charitra of all of them, when we read, then our bhakti increases, our sharanagati also increases. So, now that is called as the Ishanukatha. Ishanukatha. Nana Akhyanopa Brahmita. And along with this, there are supplementary other stories also. This is called Ishanukatha. Then, Nirodho Asya Anushayanam Atmanaha Saha Shaktivihi. Now, this is creation. Now, what about this Nirodha? Nirodha means withdrawal, meaning dissolution. So, the individual gets withdrawn, even the creation gets withdrawn. Just like individual every night goes to sleep, like that creation also comes back into pralay. Every night, Brahmaji goes to sleep, creation goes into pralay. So, Nirodha is that. Nirodha means the withdrawal of the individual soul with its qualification or adjuncts into the Lord subsequent to his retirement, and when the jiva relinquishes, so that is the individual, all the jivas go back into the Lord. So, that is the Srishti pralay. Individual pralay happens when we go to sleep. Without sleep, big problem. We can't function properly. So, every night the jiva goes into sleep. That example is given to understand how in the creation, the jivas, etc., they go back into unmanifest state. And again, they come back. So, Nirodha Asya Anushayanam Atmanaha Saha Shakti Bihi. So, when the Lord withdraws the Maya Shakti, as though all creation goes back. Just like we withdraw from our active daily routine, etc., and then we say, I want to sleep. So, everything goes into us. Same way it goes in the Lord. Nirodha Asya Anushayanam Atmanaha Saha Shakti Bihi. This next line, underline it and again memorize. Muktir hitva anyatha rupam swarupena avasthitihi. Vyavasthitihi. What is mukti? This is a beautiful definition of mukti. And this is also Advaitic definition. So nice it is. How bhakti and jnana, they get, you know, mixed. Samanvaya is so nice here. What is mukti? It is not said mukti here is you go to some loka and, you know, sit near Bhagavan or look at Bhagavan or you look like Bhagavan. Nothing. Straight. What is mukti? Hitva anyatha rupam. Give up the not self. Drop all attachment to not self. Anyatha rupam. And then what to do? Swarupena avasthiti. Abide in your true self. Satchidananda swarup atma. That is called mukti. There is no... Till that is not achieved, there is no real mukti. One may go to any loka, anywhere. One will again start the journey from where one left. And when we say, no, salokya, sarupya, samipya, sayujya, that sayujya is there, when we become one with the Lord. We saw, no, dvaita and vishishta dvaita. They don't say we become one with the Lord. The subtle body is still there. So this Advaita Vedanta Mukti is this And the objective is to gain this mukti. Mukti hitva anyatha rupam swarupena vyavasthitihi. Give up whatever identification is with the not self, with the world, objects, people, things, body, mind, intellect, ego, all that when one drops, detaches from all that, then what will happen? It is not a blank. Then what state it is? Swarupena vyavasthiti. It is your own swarupa. What? Satchidanand. That is our swarup. To be established in that properly, that I am that aham brahmasmi, not aham shunyasmi or aham dehosmi. No, no. Mukti is realized that. Now, these are the nine aspects. All these nine are to lead to ashray. So, abhasascha nirodhascha yatascha adhyavasiyate. Sa ashraya param brahma paramatmeti shabdyate. So this ashraya word is param brahma. Ashraya means saha ashraya param brahma is param brahma, and which is also called as paramatma. What does the ashraya do? Ashraya is the support, refuge of what? Creation, sustenance and destruction, everything. So when he says here, abhasa and nirodha, that is also beautiful. The word for creation uses abhas. It's full Vedant. He didn't say utpatti or sarga. He said abhas. Why? Because I told you adhishtan and ashraya are same. This snake is not a production of the rope. It is not a modification of the rope. It is not an evolution of the rope. Remember all this we have done earlier. Then what is the snake? Is only an appearance of the rope. That's called abhasa. So abhasa. So what is this abhasa? This whole creation is an appearance of what? The substratum, which is ashraya, which is param brahma and paramatma. So those who are followers of jnana will say param brahma. And the definition of brahman in the Taittiriya Upanishad is also this. Yatova ima nibhuta nijayante ye najata nijivanti yat prayanti abhisamvishanti ti tad brahma vijignyasasva. Know that to be Brahman. What? From where the creation rises, where it stays, into which it goes back, that substratum is Brahman. So abhasascha nirodhascha. So the appearance, disappearance or dissolution and the sustenance, all are in that Supreme Brahman. That is called as Abhasa, which people call as Paramatma or even Parameshwara or whatever that is. Now these are 10 topics covered, and how all the 9 must lead to the 10th one. So we saw Manvantara also, Ishanukatha also. Ishanukatha also helps to lead us to Bhagwan. Nirodha also is to help us to understand. Just like Sarga, Visarga and Poshanam Utayaha and then Nirodha. All are done by the Lord. Because where does one go back to? What is our source? From where we came, there only we will go back. Everything, when it goes away from its source, will go back to the source only. Like the water becomes vapor, it will again become water because vapor came from water. Same way ice, it again melt to become water. So from where did the srishti happen? The source of the srishti is the sthan of pralaya also. So nirodha is also that ashraya only. From ashraya the sarga happened. Ashraya visarga happened. Ashraya only sthanam, poshanam, utayaha. So if you want to divide these 9 topics, then the 9 broad topics are actually only these 3, creation, sustenance, and dissolution. That's all it is. So sarga, visarga is creation. Sthanam, poshanam, utayaha, manvantara, ishanukatha is all sustenance. And nirodha is dissolution, and mukti is going beyond all these 3 to realize my true nature, which is ashraya. So all the 8 earlier topics also come from the ashraya. The ninth one is to abide in the ashraya. So everything finally is explained only for this ashraya. That is why it is the second shloka says, Dashamasya Vishuddhyartham Navanam Iha Lakshanam. So why should I study the Bhagavatam? For ashraya. At the end of Bhagavatam, why at the end? While going through Bhagavatam itself, if ashraya did not happen, meaning I did not take the ashraya of Bhagwan, I have to take ashraya of the ashraya, one who is the refuge of all, I have to take the refuge of that supreme. May not be form of Krishna, that doesn't matter, whichever form it may be. The word is ashraya here, the word is not saying Krishna only here. It can be any form. Even it can be Omkar, no form, only sound. But the bhav is, it is Parabrahma. Then that is ashraya. And I take refuge in that. So out of many, many forms which are there, I choose one and say, this form is my ashraya. Which is why Bhagavan said, or not, Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mam Ekam Sharanam Vraja. Ekam means the ashraya. And there the word dharma can also mean this, that you may be worshipping different forms. Finally, you leave those dharmas, come to one. And surrender to that one alone. Then, Aham Tva Sarva Papebhya Moksha Ishyami. That Supreme Ishvara will take us away from all the agitations as well as the body identification. Ma Shuchaha, don't grieve. So the faster we choose one and then consider that one form as the ashraya and completely surrender where the Lord is more important to me than I. Nothing else is more important. That bhavana has to come, not intellectually alone. Intellectually I may know Swarupa Bhagavan is Sachidananda, but bhav has to come for that. So that the mind, intellect, memory, ego, meaning emotions, thoughts, memories, ahankar, everything is sublimated to Bhagavan. That person is called Param Bhagavata. Ananya Bhakta, what we call, is Param Bhagavata. Bhagavata means that person who lives the Bhagavad Dharma. What is the Bhagavad Dharma? Ashraya. In one word, Bhagavad Dharma is to take ashraya. Otherwise, I am reading Bhagavata as a storybook. And trying to find faults in that also. What is this? How is this possible? This is not possible. That is not possible. Okay, keep doing. Our job is to study this because we want to take ashraya of Bhagavan. Whether something happened or did not happen in that particular way, you have time to inquire, you keep inquiring. We will try to find out how much ever we can, but our main objective is bhakti towards the Bhagavan has to happen and Sharanagati towards the ashraya has to happen. So now, having said this, these are 10 aspects which the Bhagavatam will elaborate now. Yo adhyatmikoyam purushaha, so asau eva adhidaivikaha. Yaha tatro bhaya vichedaha purusho hyadhi bhautikaha. So now these three levels, what we know, adhidaivik, adhibhautik, adhyatmik. Why we say Shanti three times is because of this. So these three, they all are appearances of that one Lord only. So that's why he says here that the same perceiving subject which identifies itself with the sense of perception also exists in the form of the deities presiding over the senses of perception. While the physical body which distinguishes the senses from the deities presiding over them serves as the condition of the individual soul. What does that mean? Find out for yourself. A simple meaning it is. Adhyatmikoyam purushaha. The individual self which is there functioning in all the jivas. The sense of I that we have. How is that able to function? Like the eyes, how are they functioning? They are functioning because there is a presiding deity, Surya, Chakshusha Suryaha, रसनायाः वरुणः घ्राणस्य अश्विनौ. सो दैट इज द आदिदैविक एस्पेक्ट. That supreme consciousness, which has become the individual jiva, is only appearing as the adhidaivik level also, the phenomenal forces, devatas. Yaha tatra ubhaya vichedaha purushohi adi bhautikaha. And that only has become this phenomenal world also. Because the senses need objects to experience. So this one only has become three, and all the three are actually one. So this is important to understand. One has become three, and all three are also one. They are not separatable. You cannot separate them. Today's world, our problem is we have separated them. It is one whole. It is one system. It cannot function in its with only one part, because they all are connected. They function only together, three things. For example, if the objects are not there, the capability of seeing will not function properly. If the sense capability is there to function, it needs a presiding deity. If Surya Devata is not there, the eyes won't be able to see. So Surya Devata has to be there, capability of seeing, and the eyes have to be there, then the object has to be there. All the three are one, connected. You cannot say that, oh, I don't believe in Surya Devata, I only believe in sun. Arre, sun is the part of the gross world, adi bhautik world. What makes that sun function? That intelligence is Surya Devata. From where that Surya Devata got that intelligence? That is Supreme Brahman, that Ashraya only. What we have done is we have cut that Adi Daivik level. Why? Because not visible to us. Adhyatmic level and Adi Bhautik level visible, experienceable. Even in Adhyatmic level, the depth of Adhyatmic level not experienceable. Just because I see through the eyes means I have the capability to see on its own. So the source of this adhyatmic level also I have cut. And the adibhautik level also I have cut the source. It all came from Ashraya, which is Bhagwan. So Ashraya of both is cut. Now what I believe? Senses are alone there, functioning on its own. And they are able to perceive the world. From where the world came? Nature created. Nature created both these. Very good. But the Bhagavatam is very clear. You cannot cut both these. They are all one. One will not function without the other two. And so it is that whatever is seen will have an adhibhautik level, adhyatmik level, and adhidaivik level. Everything. So if I see a mountain, that's a gross Adi Bhautik level, there will be an Adi Daivik level of it also. What is the Adi Daivik level of it? There will be a mountain, so Parvata Devata will be there, who is presiding over that mountain. That's why we say Govardhan or Giriraj, mountain of the king of mountains. And when we do Govardhan Parikrama, we are not doing Parikrama of only a physical mountain. Physical mountain is the expression of that Giriraj, who is a devotee of the Lord. What is the adhyatmic level of that mountain? The adhyatmic level is that it is the sat aspect which is manifest as the mountain. If you put subtle body into that, then chit chaitanya aspect also will start functioning. It will start responding. So every single thing will have an adhidevik, adhibhautik, adhyatmic angle. But we don't see it as a whole. No? That's why we exploit the nature then. And we destroy ourselves also. Both happens. So he says, ekam ekatara bhave. What I just said, no? That one in the absence of the other, ekam ekatara abhave, yada na upalabhamahe. We cannot experience. Tritayam yatra yo veda sa atma swashrayashraya. The one who is the knower of all the three is the self who doesn't have any other ashraya. It is the final ashraya. Swashrayashraya, who is the ashraya of itself, meaning it doesn't have any other ashraya. Meaning the Supreme Lord is the ashraya of all the three, but the Lord himself has no other ashraya. And that Supreme Lord is our Atma. True self is that. You see, when it is clear that in the absence of any of these, we cannot perceive the other two, it follows that he who knows all these three is the ashraya or support of all, and this latter has no other support than himself. What we call in Vedanta as Swayambhu. By itself it exists. It doesn't have any other cause. So here it is called Swashraya Ashraya. It has no other ashraya. It is the ultimate ashraya. So now this is about the 10 topics. Okay. Now in these 10 topics, the first topic is Sarga. So now from verses 10 up to 35, 10 to 35 describes Sarga, creation. Then 36 to 47 describes Visarga. So the first two topics of these 10 is covered in this chapter already. Sarga and Visarga. That I will take up in the next class. See that Sarga and Visarga, which is there, no, two times I've already done this creation theory, okay? And it is subtle. This one is not as complicated as the earlier ones. But my suggestion to you is you please read these verses 10 to 35, even till 47. You read before and come, because I am not going to go shloka-wise here. I will tell you the principle, and then it's just elaboration of that same principle it is. How the senses are created and all that. So then we will conclude this chapter in the next satsang. But your homework is you must read 10 to 37. 10 to 47, sorry. You please read that. That is your homework. Shrutiji, yes.
Yeah, Hari Om Swamiji. So when we look at the what you just said, Swamiji, about the Adhyatmik, the Adibhatik and the... You can hear me, right?
Now I can hear, yes.
Okay. So what you spoke about the Adidaivik, Adibhautik and the Adhyatmik levels. If we look at the same example in terms of, even if we understand it as that when we see, so if there's an object that is to be seen and there is the seeing and there is the ability to see, in that, even if we look at it in terms of the object, the material cause is nothing but the same ashraya. And the intelligent cause, the ability to see in the ability to see is nothing but the intelligent cause is nothing but that same ashraya.
Ability to see is the adidaivik cause, huh?
The
phenomenal
ability,
force.
That is a phenomenal force, but that is also an intelligent cause. Only. So if we look at it, then in terms of if we look at it from material cause and intelligent cause, even then we come to the same answer, right?
Yes.
So even if we don't get into the thing of Adibhautik, Adidaivik, because I think maybe one way of explaining even to myself is phenomenal forces are ultimately, it is an intelligent cause. It's not an intelligent cause like you said earlier. It is not something that nature can produce on its own. It's not something that cells can just have consciousness within them. So it has to have come from, it has to have had an intelligent cause. So is that also another way of being able to understand the Adi Daivik level? Where when we understand phenomenal forces, where we have given them the name of Devatas, but it is like the ability is, it's a conscious principle. It's not just an unconscious power that just exists.
No doubt. It is a conscious principle, and what you said, we can consider it as an intelligent entity, intelligent cause appearing in this form, because appearing for the ability to function. But that explanation is applicable as far as I'm using it for me as an individual. But I have, when I look at it as the creation, then there has to be a devata. Because sun, moon, star came from where? How are they functioning? In this example you gave of seeing, that is a subjective example. In an objective example, the devata is functioning whether I exist or not. So that means the Adidevic level exists. So if we are wanting to negate the devata concept because it is not appealing, because to some it happens like that, then that is not correct. But otherwise the interpretation is fine. You are unmuted. You are muted. If you are saying something, I can't hear.
Sorry, I was unable to unmute myself. I'm not trying to negate the devatas, just trying to get an understanding at the, like you said, at the individual level. Because frankly, I think at the samashti level, it is easier to understand. Because it becomes so clear that if the sun is giving light, if all of that is giving light, how can they be giving light? So the one is able to understand, I'm able to understand the Adidaivik level better at that level. But in the Vyashti, it becomes a little harder to understand that. Though ultimately one, if one attaches it to Vyashti is part of Samashti, what is happening in Vyashti has to be happening in Samashti, then of course it becomes totally clear. But just trying to understand it from all levels possible, I guess. So that every explanation has to ultimately add up. They can't be separate from each other. So if I attack it from, or if I approach it rather from an instrumental material cause, it's got to be able to add up to even the Adidaivik, Adibhautik and Adhyatmik levels, is what I'm trying to do, I guess.
Yeah.
Then that's okay, right?
That's fine.
Okay, thank you, Swami.
Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.